the Fundy Fringe Festival, uncensored, unjuried, and unbelievably entertaining. F4 Fringe Power is radio in support of the Fundy Fringe Festival on local 107.3 FM. That's F4. You're listening to Fringe Power.
Happy fourth episode, everyone. The 2022 Fundy Fringe Theater Festival is on right now, running August 21st to the 27th. The 10th Fundy Fringe has shows for everyone across their three venues along Princess Street. The BMO Studio at 112 Princess Street, the Warehouse just down the road, and the tent out back of the old Fundy Fringe Hub at 112 Princess Street as well. You can get access there through the hub, or I think you can go around Horsefield Street as well. A very close walking distance between them all, so you can hashtag binge the fringe, or fringe binge, whichever you prefer. Still only 10 bucks a ticket, with all the money still going straight to the artists. So don't wait. Like I said, the Fringe is on now. So visit them online at www.fundyfringefestival.com for more information. I don't know if I need to say www anymore. It's 2022 after all. But you can also check out the Fundy Fringe on Facebook. There you can plan when, where, and what unique theater piece to start with. Plus, if you can't make it in person, well, you can buy tickets to stream a Fundy Fringe show at home or wherever and whenever. So grab a button with a donation and hashtag check their socials. There's also many Fundy Fringe events you can enjoy each night after the shows. Congratulations, Fundy Fringe, for 10 years of Fringe in the Fog City, Port City. And now, a word from our sponsor, Baba Ganoush. Give your loved one what they really want. Hot, creamy eggplant. Wait a sec. This is exactly what I mean about confusing our eyes. We can't say that. Stop. Can we? Can we really say that? Gentle audience, some of you may remember our contract with the International Eggplant Council for Resources Development and Research commits us to insert an eggplant emoji with every Fringe Power branded social media post. This has many people confused, if not uncomfortable. I here apologize if we at Fringe Power have offended in any way. We are very grateful for the sponsorship Baba Ganoush has given us, even though the money hasn't reached our office yet, just a lot of discount Baba Ganoush. I'm still reliant on the old Fringe phone, and I must apologize again to all of our guests whom have been victim to its poor sound quality. It did work fairly well when I called up our first guest. Tom Hearn returns to the Fundy Fringe with a brand new show, Gay Garbage. And we managed to get Tom on the Fringe phone last week while Tom was still performing at the Edmonton Fringe.
Hello,
Tom Hearn.
Hello, how are you?
Good. Can you hear me okay?
I can hear you okay. Can you hear me all right?
Yeah, absolutely. That's great. Hey, thanks again for your time. This is like the third, fourth, fifth time you've been on the show. Really appreciate your time.
I love being a recurring guest on this show.
You're happy anytime. Yeah, we'll put you down as a recurring character. Or how about just like a regular?
Yeah, I like that. That's nice.
Well, I was thinking about it. It's like your work, like you're in Edmonton right now, aren't you?
I'm in Edmonton right now, yeah.
Okay. So your work's getting a lot of distance. It's giving you a lot of opportunities. I was thinking about that the other day. We have a lot of reoccurring performers at the Fundy Fringe. So I take it mm-hmm. It's more than your home province, but you enjoy coming, right?
I love coming to Fundy Fringe. It's like one of my favorite festivals to do in the entire country.
Oh, wonderful. No, we appreciate that. Yeah. And
it's always such an amazing time.
You're in a garden.
Oh my gosh.
You're blowing up Instagram there with that in a garden impersonation. That's what?
Yeah. So, it's wild. It's something that I didn't expect, and that's the power of the internet.
So is that your is that going to be your alter ego now? Because you're getting a lot of attention with that, and it seems like it'll be a lot of fun.
Yeah, I've been having the time of my life doing it. Every time I drop one of those videos, I get more and more. My jaw gets lower and lower to the floor. The fact that people still find it funny and they still want more of it. So I will ride that homemade gravy train all the way until it comes to a close.
Now, do you walk away? I assume you study her. You study her videos a lot. Do you walk away with any cooking tips? Do you cook at home, or do you just do it for the comedy?
That's so funny. I actually don't take any cooking tips from her. I'm not a very good cook myself. So it's more of just a fun thing for me. But I've watched her show for years before I ever did this. I had, like, you know how Facebook does those, like, memories that pop up?
Yeah.
I had one pop up the other day. It was, like, 6 years ago, and I was, like, saying something about Ina Garten. I was like, oh, I've been a fan for a long time. And I truly just randomly did an Ina Garten video one night while my partner was making a roast chicken, and the rest is history.
That's perfect. So it's Ina Garten. See, I'm bad at pronouncing names. It's Ina Garten.
Ina Garten. But you know what? So many people, I get Ina. I think she gets the whole gambit, so I think she takes anything.
Oh, perfect. So you're coming here with a new show called Gay Garbage, or is it just Garbage?
It's Gay Garbage.
Gay Garbage, okay.
Yeah.
Now that's perfect. I know you're a fan favorite. Everyone talks about your shows, you know, when they come here. I remember Slang was very popular. And
yeah, I had a great time doing Slang at Fundy Fringe.
I know, that's going to be great. So what's different about Gay Garbage than the other shows that you've brought to us?
So Gay Garbage is a completely new show. So if you've seen my solo work before at Fundy Fringe, you can expect the same type of energy, the same type of gusto, the same type of loud, crass comedy, but completely new. You've never seen any of these sketches, songs, characters before.
Okay.
And yeah, Gay Garbage, it comes from me working at Comedy Bar and doing a show. And one night a woman came out and said to a cast member that was with me in the show, she said to him, you know, I liked when you were on stage because you didn't do that Gay Garbage.
Oh.
And I went, oh, so I'm the Gay Garbage. Great. I'm going to run with that. And yeah, so I've just been curating all of these different characters and stories. It's really about, it's like I describe it as like an ode to my queerness.
Okay.
It's taking all the things that I don't like about people's perceptions of me and my queerness and flipping them on its head and taking the piss out of it.
Oh, that's great. Well, you're my well, not so secret crush anymore, Tom. So I appreciate
Yes, I did it.
I appreciate you've turned me, boy. You've turned me.
I turned you. I did it.
Hey, it led me to a question. Your drag, like you incorporate quite a bit of drag into your shows now. And I was talking about it with some other people about how the drag arts have become quite mainstream now. And I mean, I know some people, they take their kids to shows when they can, and they just have a great time. They love the entertainment. They love the art form.
Yep.
And which led me and the boys there we developed a question. Is it okay for a straight guy to perform drag, or is it specifically, For the gay community? Is that a political? Is that a hot topic? I mean, is that too political? Is that too?
No, not at all.
No?
Oh my gosh! No, I actually talk. So I'm gonna dissect this into two parts. First of all, speaking to the mainstreamness of drag and children going to see drag shows, I actually speak on this exact issue in my show. I have a sketch that's inspired by the online hate that Justin 2Deep, who is featured in my show, mm-hmm. while I'm in St. John, experience with their drag time story time. I wrote a piece based on that, and I'm performing it here in Edmonton. And one of the reviewers who came to my show was like, oh, it's so great that you wrote a piece based on a local story here in Edmonton. And I was like, wait a second. And the exact same thing happened here. So, like, drag is becoming very mainstream, and it is opening doors and minds of individuals, but that comes with vitriol and hate from these right-wing individuals who try and manipulate what a drag time story time is to fit their narrative of what they think it is.
Mm-hmm.
So there's that component. But then to speak to your other component of can a straight man do drag? Yes, you absolutely can. I think it comes from a place of respect first.
Yes.
Respecting the people who were there first. There was just a straight drag drag queen on RuPaul's Drag Race last season.
Oh, okay.
The first straight queen ever on the show.
Oh, okay.
I don't think it's a very common thing. I personally have never met a straight cis man who does drag, but I would be supportive of that as long as they understand the drag world and the queer world from a place of extreme privilege, mm-hmm. and knowing that as they navigate through becoming a drag performer, that they have to listen and learn from the people who have been there first, instead of coming in and trying to, for lack of a better word, take over I definitely think that there is room. I think there's room for everybody to do drag. It has to come from a place of respect first.
Gotcha. Know the history, respect the art form and the performers. I get it. I mean, it's more than just putting.
Yeah, you got it.
It's more than just putting on a dress and a wig.
A wig and a dress. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
exactly.
That's great.
There's more to it.
So on that topic, is gay garbage, is that something that you could bring your kids to, or is it more adult-like?
I would say my shows always skew a little bit more adult. I would say, like, a teen could come to my show. If your teen watches Drag Race, then they can come to the show.
Okay.
I think it just comes from whatever your comfort level is with your child. But, like, I do, as you know, from a Tom Hearn show, a Tom Hearn experience, there is sexually charged performances happening.
Yeah.
So if your child, I wouldn't say child, if your teen is allowed to view something that would be rated, I'd say, like 14A, then they can definitely come to my show.
Great, great. And these...
But this isn't like a drag time story time situation,
okay.
where I'm going to sit there and read Charlotte's Web to the kids. it's a little bit more crass than that.
Okay, great. And you can stream these online now. I think I just heard that they do have streaming capabilities, so you can buy a show and watch. You could buy a ticket and watch your show online now.
Yeah, you can. Yeah, that's very exciting. That's one of the holdovers from the pandemic that I would like to keep around.
Yeah, no, that's. It's exciting to be able to keep that component.
One of the only things I'd keep around.
That's right. That's right. So you're going to be in Edmonton for another day or two, and then you're heading to St. John?
Yes, I'm here, and I have my last show tomorrow night, and then I fly red-eye to Moncton, and then I have my first preview show, The Big Tease, which I love doing, on Sunday night.
Okay, so you're going to be at the Big Tease, which kind of kicks off the whole festival, which is great. Perfect.
Yes.
Well, thank you, Tom. I really appreciate your time, and we're going to keep watching you on social media and get tickets either online or in person over at the Fundy Fringe Festival for Gay Garbage.
Absolutely. I can't wait to see everybody there. Can't wait to see you there.
You too. And one more thing. You mentioned it earlier. You have Justin Too Deep in the show that's with you for the Fundy Fringe, right?
Yeah, I have Justin Too Deep. I have Diamond, and then from Halifax on my. I'm closing the. This is my favorite part about Fundy Fringe. They always give me the last spot of the festival.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm closing out the festival again with a big, big drag extravaganza. I have a couple of friends coming from Halifax to come to the show. So I have Brooke Rivers and Trinity Fox also coming to join. So that Saturday night, 10 p.m., is going to be It will sell out, so if you want to come to the party show, that is going to be the party show, so make sure you get your tickets in advance.
Wonderful. Thanks a lot. Always great talking to you, Tom, and I can't wait to have you back in St. John.
Can't wait to see you.
Great. Thanks again. We'll see you soon.
Thank you. Talk to you soon.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
That was Tom Hearn, and their show Gay Garbage is on now, August 21st to the 27th at the BMO Studio, 112 Princess Street. Check Facebook for the day's showtime. I want to take this moment to apologize for all my poor attempts at performing drag myself. I will do better. I will be better. And I also want to apologize to our next guest. Oy vey, this suddenly become an apology episode. I'm sorry for the last 10 years. For a couple seasons now, I've promised Tabraze Sheikh some of my family's secret borscht recipe, halal style. And have I yet to deliver? Still, Tabraze welcomes me to talk about his return to the Fundy Fringe with his award-winning production, Dangerous Lies. We met with Tabraze at the new location of his restaurant, Nanya Business.
I've been great. Wonderful. We're
I haven't seen you around, so I've honestly been missing you a little bit, buddy.
I know. I've been really busy the last little while. It's just been crazy. You know, I've got cats. I got a lot of little jobs around the city, and
cats are the worst.
They can be. It's like
so demanding.
I don't know why anyone would want a roommate when they've got a cat, because that's just or get married. I don't know. I mean, I'm sure there's a lot of people that will disagree with me.
Do you need a high demand spouse or roommate?
Yeah.
But cheaper?
Yeah.
Cat.
Someone that screams at you when you come home?
Cat.
Someone that and this is non-gender.
Yeah.
Right. Emphasis on the non, which we're at Tabraze's. That's my next question. We're at the new Nanya Business restaurant location, which will be opening soon. I'm with Tabraze Sheikh.
Yes.
Now,
perfect pronunciation.
Thank you.
We've been friends for how long?
I know, and I'm bad with pronouncing names, but I do remember that from. I think you instructed me last time, or one of the times that we've met, because you've definitely been on the show before, and we appreciate that. Congratulations on the restaurant.
Thank you.
This is great. You're moving on up from the.
The east side.
I liked it. Yes. I like the quaint little spot you had in City Market, but this is wonderful. Yeah. What is the address, exact address?
231 Churchill Boulevard.
Right.
Where the old Jacko's used to be.
Old Jacko's right next to the old Somerset Pub. So all Maritimers and all those type of directions.
Great. Exactly.
So, the possessive of your name, Tabraze's or Tabraze New Place. What would you think? What's your angle on that? Do you pronounce the Tabraze's or Tabraze? Right.
Shouldn't we just call it Robbins? Because really, like...
It's Robbins doing all the cooking, anyway, right?
No, it's that, like, you know, that old adage, what's, you know, wives always say, what's yours is mine, and what's mine is also mine. My wife loves that one.
Jeez, we're trying to be woke, and I think we're borderline.
I'm being very woke, guys. I'm saying that, like, I am absolutely down for my wife being in control of this place.
Giving the credit where credit is due.
I want her to have her name in lights.
And she's not like a cat where she'd be, like, screaming for food every half hour either.
Exactly.
No, Robin's great. Robin's in the back. Robin, the other half of the Modern Mind Readers. But your Fundy Fringe show that's coming up this week, mm-hmm. Again... Dangerous Lies.
Yeah.
Which has, you, after the last time you performed at the Fundy Fringe, you went to the Halifax Fringe.
Correct.
Winning awards.
As always.
Congratulations on that, sir. That's wonderful.
Thank you.
Well, you won an award for it here in the Fundy Fringe as well,
right? I won an award for it here at the Fundy Fringe, Halifax Fringe. I got another award it's called the Stages, we'll just call it the Stages Award because I've forgotten the name.
Okay.
So it's been quite a successful show.
Yeah.
But really, it's, I think that the truth, the success of the show doesn't lie in the awards, but rather the impact and the message that's left with people.
Of course. I just wanted to make sure congratulated you on the awards.
You.
Yeah. As we sit in your new restaurant to be, and as of course you can tell because of the poor sound quality that I'm providing this interview, it obviously it's a show very near and dear, very personal, very personal show. But I was curious, why select this one again? Is there something new, or you just enjoy the show?
I am actually retiring the show after the Fun Fringe.
Are you really?
Okay. I am indeed. So I wanted to end it where it all started.
Okay.
You know, at the Fundy Fringe. And honestly, like, it's been quite an emotional roller coaster carrying this show now for the last year or so. Mm-hmm. I think it's quite fitting that it comes to an end where it started.
Okay, so it's like you basically started the tour here and you're ending the tour here.
Correct.
Okay. I thought maybe there was something different about the show that you've added to
it. Oh, no, there most definitely is. That's the beauty of the Fringe Festival, is that not only is it a performance venue, but it's a literally trial by fire, put your show through its paces and very quickly adjust for the next night. And that's kind of why I've brought it back again, because it's gone through its final evolution, as it were.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I've been doing that final evolution now for a little while, and I thought it'd be fitting to stop here.
Okay, good.
Yes.
Good. So it's, and it gives, after all these awards, it gives people another chance to see the show that may have missed it or see it again.
Exactly.
But you're still Muslim in the show, right?
I'm still Muslim in real life.
Okay,
yes.
Great. Okay, well, that's great. Okay, perfect. I didn't know if there was any changes like that. Hello, Robin. Great. So was there any part of the show that you did over time that you said, maybe I should have left this part out? Or maybe there's something of the show that I should have focused more on? Like, was there anything that you regretted?
In all honesty, no. Because, you know, it took me 4 years to write the show.
Mm-hmm.
So in terms of the writing and the story, I think I really narrowed it down to where I wanted it to be.
Mm-hmm.
The only differences that have come and the changes that have come in are, you know, minor scripting changes, maybe saying things a little bit differently,
mm-hmm.
portraying emotion a little bit differently. What else? Just how do you connect the message and the show to the audience?
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's really what's changed.
Very, yes, very.
But sorry.
It's very actorish. Very actorish.
Well, Tim, we've been friends long enough now. You know, you're rubbing off on me.
Okay. Yeah. You still have the. I don't want to say magic, because you. That's not a term we use, right?
The muggles.
Yeah. but you still have the element of your.
The ESP stuff, the mind reading.
Yeah, the mind reading. Yeah, yes. I'm trying to find the right word for it because...
I know, I was reading your mind.
Yeah, boom, oh my gosh. Because magic isn't the right term.
Correct.
Right. So, that still is a strong component in the show. That didn't change, right?
Absolutely.
Okay. But are there different events, or are they the same events people would have seen last time? Because doesn't that go against the rule?
No, because you see, the thing with ESP, with mind reading, all this, is that it's not the experiments or the conditions that change.
Mm-hmm.
It's the subjects, right? And we all think differently. We all react differently. We all have different thoughts, chains of emotion. So, you know, even though I might do the same thing 100 times,
mm-hmm.
it'll never feel the same because each and every one of us isn't the same.
Okay. Because I was like, wait, isn't that like, that goes against the, and I know, magic, rule of magic, right? You don't do the same trick twice, right? In front of, but no, but this, of course, isn't magic.
Exactly.
And
so I'm fine.
Yeah, you're great. You're great. What kind of,
47,
that was okay. No, that's good. Now, I was just thinking, what kind of things can we expect from you and Robin in the future. Is like I kind of joked around saying, well, when's it time for Robin to have her a personal one-person show? But are you going to be you're retiring this show, but are you going to be doing any more modern mind reader stuff?
Absolutely. We're, like I said, I'm in the process of writing a new show for the modern mind readers that we're actually going to just tour with. That's going to be more of the touring show for, you know, corporate universities, colleges, and such.
Okay, good. And of course, we can still find you on social media, the modern mind readers.
Absolutely.
And be able to follow you there and check out. Wait. I have to like my boss of my corporation's got to bring you in. Like, is there, like, I can still see you at a show, right? Like, yeah. I can still, there's still, you'll still have those.
Oh, like public events?
Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Like I said,
I don't know if I missed that, but
yeah, no, it's
okay.
We always write shows that are like, any, if you want to hire us or if you want to have us at your event, you know, that is the show that we bring. So
okay, great. Yes. And they can contact you through your socials.
Actually, I don't know if you know this or not. Robin is also doing, or she has been doing, while I've been doing Dangerous Lies, she's been doing chocolate readings.
Yeah. No, we saw those, and we did share some posts about the chocolate readings.
You ate a whole box of chocolate, and Robin just said diabetes. That's all she saw in your future.
That's everything. I didn't know she did my chocolate reading without me. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, you took the box and ran. I mean,
oh, gosh. So yeah, because you used to do that in City Market. Is there any other places where, like, would you be able to come to the restaurant here, Nanya Business, on Somerset Drive, and be able to get a chocolate reading at Nanya Business?
Why not? Certainly.
Okay.
Like I said, just give us a call. We'll bring in the chocolates.
Okay, because I got that post late, and I came down to City Market, and it was already kind of finished, so I was kind of disappointed I didn't get. She eats the chocolate, or I eat the chocolate?
Well, I'm sure she eats the chocolate when no one's looking, but no, it's
like what is, like a chocolate reading, like, so.
Oh, yeah, that should be left to the master. I would do it a disservice describing what it is.
Okay, so I'll have to take that up with, but it's popular. It's on the nose. It's good.
It's chocolate. Who doesn't like chocolate?
And you get a reading.
And you get a reading. And perfect. Chocolate.
That, I'm sold. Yeah. You got me on that one.
Yeah.
And everything else is going well here. How's Leo the parrot?
Leo, in case anyone doesn't know, Leo is my parrot, and he's doing swimmingly.
Good. Yes. Oh, I'm glad.
Or should I say,
He's taking off.
He's soaring.
That's good.
Yeah.
Well, I hope everything's...
All the puns.
We're about puns.
Yeah. Tim is in deep thought.
Yeah, no, I just, you know, it's been a while since I've seen you, and, you know, I get...
I missed you too, buddy.
I miss you, and Robin, you know, of course, you know.
Still waiting on that borscht.
I know. Okay, so the borscht is happening. I even bought a huge amount of beets. I bought a sickening amount of beets. I even got the halal beef, right? Because, you know, I wasn't going to use pork in it, obviously. But then I got busy in the beets. I thought beets were like potatoes. They could kind of stay for a while, right? But no, beets hate you after a couple days. And there. So I didn't get a chance to make it. But I am going to make that. And we're going to try the... So that borscht is coming, and then if you try my borscht, I'll try your Wrath of Naan sauce.
Considering we've terminated the Wrath of Naan Wrath of Naan challenge.
Yeah.
So, but I still have some leftover sauce, so yes, I will definitely give that to you.
And that's right, it's not naan bread.
It is naan.
It's just naan.
Yeah.
It's like asking for bread.
Bread.
Okay. Oh.
They're coming for you.
No, I think...
Maybe me. I said nan.
Welcome to the neighborhood. Great. Well, Tabraze, I'm really glad that you're back at the Fundy Fringe.
Thank you.
Wow. You know, being able to do the show and continue to do the show and to the success that it has received...
Thank you.
We appreciate us getting a chance to see it again.
Thank you.
So thank you. Thank you very much. And all the best wishes with the restaurant.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. It really, I'll be honest with you, it means the world to me that I can do this again. Because, you know, I I don't know if I ever told you this. Drag this on.
Hey, I need the content, man. You drag it on as long as you want.
The story of how the show came to be was actually my mother. She saw Robin and I performing all the time. She was actually one of those people who helped us out quite a bit. Every time she came to visit, she had something random in her purse, and she's like, tell me what it is.
Well, she come up from Texas, right?
Correct.
Yeah.
Correct. So one day we had a talk, and she kind of looked at me, and she was like, you know, Tabraze, why don't you write something meaningful, something that will, you know, something that'll affect people and, you know, make them better, you know. And one of the things my mom taught me very early on was the lessons on racism and how it's not okay. And her favorite thing to say was, you know, it doesn't matter if you're white, black, brown, yellow, purple, in the eyes of God, we're all equal, right? Mm-hmm. So, you know, because of her, I started writing Dangerous Lies based on the experiences that we had to go through with racism in America and the Islamophobia as well. And then before I could premiere the show, my mother had passed away.
So
she never got to see it. That's why the show is in honor of her, because, you know, if it wasn't for her, the show wouldn't have been. And she knew about the show. She knew that I was writing it. So, but it's God's will, and, you know, I pray for her constantly, but I thank her immensely, because if it wasn't for her, this show wouldn't have come to fruition.
Yeah, so. Great. I did, I can completely understand that. And, we just hope that you have an amazing time and a wonderful closing to this chapter in your life, I guess.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Quite impressive. But thank you. Thank you very much, Tabraze.
Thank you.
That was Tabraze Sheikh and the other half of the Modern Mind Readers, Robin. Go see Dangerous Lies. It's on now at the BMO Studio. This is your last chance to see this award-winning play. Then, book a reservation at Nanya Business for their opening this weekend. You can have your own after Fringe Rap Party.
The Reconciliation Studies Graduate Certificate at St. Stephen's University is currently in the process of rolling out its inaugural semester and wants you to participate. Reconciliation Studies is informed by the Truth and Reconciliation Commission's calls to action and was designed in conjunction with Indigenous community leaders and faculty to equip professionals to handle engagement with Indigenous communities thoughtfully and respectfully. Courses can be taken for credit or audited, on their own, or as part of a larger degree. They take place primarily online, with a brief intensive each semester in St. Stephen's, New Brunswick. Staff at SSU would be happy to talk to potential students in more detail about how to best fit Reconciliation Studies into their schedule. Please visit ssu.ca for more information. Again, please visit ssu.ca for more information on the Reconciliation Studies Graduate Certificate.
St. John's Alternative Radio, local, 107.3 FM.
Quinn Adams and Cameron Secord, appreciate you coming by. Thank you very much. And you have you know what, you guys, I really appreciate it even more because, like, you're the newest blood I've had on the show in ages. So
thanks for having us.
No, I mean, because, like, I get a lot of repeat offenders, which is great, right? But no, it's always nice to talk to new people. Is this your first fun? No. This isn't your first Fundy Fringe, is it, Cameron?
No, this will be my third. I wrote two shows pre-pandemic, and then this will be my third one post-pandemic, and I have been in all three because I just can't help myself, but I know that there are many other scripts on the go that don't involve me. It's just Fringe is to have fun and is to write with your friends, and that's just what we did today, and that's what we've done this year.
So you categorized your work pre and post.
Yep.
What do you think? Is there a real difference in your writing pre and post-pandemic?
Not theme-wise, maturity-wise. And I've been saying this, like, I feel like I wasn't thinking twice about what I was going to put into a script that may affect someone, you know, that doesn't affect me on that level. And then now I've been more mature and picking my words more wisely in a way that resonates with everybody and not just one group of people.
Okay, you know what I mean. That's fair. That's fair. You're writing for not just yourself.
Yeah.
That's cool. Cool. Mm-hmm. And Quinn Adams, is this is your first Fringe period? Okay.
Yeah.
So how did you become involved with Mr. Secord here?
So we actually met through a cast party from the main stage production of Little Shop of Horrors with St. John Theatre Company. So I was in the ensemble for that cast, and Cam crashed the cast party.
always a great tradition. Always good to do. So,
I'm glad he did, because he came right over, introduced himself, and right away he's like, we will work together soon.
Yeah.
And here we are, post-pandemic, I guess, and he gave me the script to this show, and I read it as like a fan, as an actor, as a writer, and it made sense on all three levels. I read the script and was like, wow. And not even knowing, he was asking me to be a part of it at the time. And so it's a two-man show, and I'm so excited that we finally found the opportunity to work together.
That's good, yeah, because, I mean, crashing cast parties is pretty much St. John's way of networking.
Yeah, you got it, Tim. No, we know.
two-person show.
It is, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, good. Now you guys are Virgo Theater?
That's
considered
right.
Virgo Theater?
Yes.
Okay, and the show is called One Night in Milwaukee?
That's correct.
It's home of the Fonz.
Hey, man, the thing about Milwaukee and Wisconsin in general is that we don't think for a second we weren't thinking of maybe putting on that kind of style and having an attitude and an accent that would resonate that way. We just didn't, let's put it this way, when you have material and you have to rely on an accent, you want to pick one. So we realized that the Maritime-ish accent that we have here can be something equivalent to what Wisconsin people would enjoy if they came to see a show that was based in Milwaukee.
That's Cam's nice way of saying, I cannot do accents. So we decided to drop it.
Yeah. And I think that's fair. You know, yeah. I mean, after a while you get distracted by the accent, if it's good or bad. I did a show where I had to have an Irish accent, and it was so hard on my throat, the way they wanted me, like the particular area of Ireland that they wanted me to do, which I can't remember at the time, but it was like right in the back. 2 hours of talking, because it was a two-person show.
Yeah,
you're like distracted by the accent. And then I performed a juried production of it, and there was, I think it was 60% people from Dublin in the audience, and they came after the show and they had corrected all my pronunciations.
Oh, cool.
It was so awful. I was like, oh my god,
because it's not even just like the tonality of it, like it's also like the rhythm of the Irish accent, like
and knowing what you're talking about,
and
too.
There's the slang, like I find each town, even like you could have someone from a town over, like we'd never say that, but the town next to it might, right? Like and it's great, even here we have that too, like
we do have that here.
Accents are tricky.
But no, it's good. stick with focusing on the story. You're probably good. So but what is the story about One Night in Milwaukee?
So One Night in Milwaukee is basically, I'm a big fan of true crime inspired events, and if I'm my go-to genre, my go-to theme, I really do enjoy thriller, suspenseful watches and reads. So when I came across a script called A Steady Rain by Keith Huff, which was about a year and a half ago, it was this beautiful, gritty script about two police officers who are involved in a true crime situation and about a true crime individual. So when I looked at that, I realized, okay, and this was from the get-go, Quinn and I cannot play two 40, 50-year-old men, and the context didn't make sense for us as Cameron and Quinn to play those characters. So we basically, and I say we because I had Quinn in mind from the get-go, created our own concept and kind of went Quentin Tarantino on that script to create our own completely original, similar context, yet original version of that true crime situation.
So yeah, your own adaptation.
Yeah.
Yeah. And if I'm, when you say like it's like Quentin Tarantino, it's really like that kind of like time hopping throughout the story, and you're piecing it together, asking questions, not really knowing what's going to happen until maybe it's too late and you were already told, and then you find out later, as well as just the dialogue being so raw, you know, because it is a duologue. So we are speaking with each other and speaking with the audience, and so everyone's kind of involved in this the storytelling experience. Yeah.
Duologues can be a little challenging. People will see them on certain scripts because, and some people just have to look it up. Sometimes they'll give an explanation on scripts, and it's not, you know, it's not a very popular thing you'll find, but some people write them where you have to, as a director or an actor, know if you're talking to your counterpart or if you are talking to the audience themselves, because the way it's written and the way dialogue scenes can be is that it will go back and forth between the audience being that third character in the room and that third actor.
So yeah, they're almost like a counselor.
Exactly. So the audience is very much alive during this production. They're not saying anything. They can react all they want. We will be addressing them because we need to, because they are the third person in the room.
But it's not audience participation.
No, absolutely not.
Okay, okay. Because that can scare off some people.
Absolutely not.
But once you do it, you know, it's fun. Yeah. But, you know, okay. And so, as you say, it was kind of a Quinton Camerontino.
Beautiful.
I like that. Trademark. I like that. So, the style that you say that you've got this this show, does that rule out a certain age group? I mean, it's more for an older audience?
Definitely. Yeah. So, like, the rating systems, I know, like, are different in Canada versus the United States and everything. Like, I would put, like, a heavy 14A on it, you know? Like, but there are definitely some darker subjects covered in it. So.
Okay. Of course. If we toned back the language, I'm sure we could get a 14A rating because we're sticking to the language on the script. And it makes, because it makes sense, we are going with that R rating. So it will be at the Fun Day Fringe Festival. I believe it's 18 or 17 and up. That will be accompanied or with a parent, of course.
Yeah. And that is what the Fringe is all about, like that uncensored kind of raw art.
Yeah.
But we do plan on stripping the show at some point and maybe like coming out with different versions for different age groups to maybe put it out to a wider audience or even like some schools or things like that in the future.
Just curious
but
if
for
you
now,
can bring your kids. Yeah.
For now, it's definitely an R rating.
Yeah. Yeah, good.
You can bring your kids if they're a teenager. Yeah, I'm sure accompanied by an adult.
At your own risk.
At your own risk. Yeah.
So when I think of Milwaukee, right, obviously I think of the Fonz, Richie, you know, Mr. C. But is this going, are these references going right over your head?
No, but it's funny because I'll admit to it that I either was very young or wasn't alive, but don't think I don't do my research.
No,
because you know.
No happy days. No happy
I'm
days.
I'm a big fan of the show Barry on HBO. It's Bill Hader's show.
Yeah.
And Henry Winkler is actually the supporting lead in that. So I just got a healthy obsession with him. I watch all his interviews now. And I just wish I was around when he was that legendary.
Yeah.
Because like, that's not him at all.
No,
like, he's the most sweet man, it seems. So get the reference, but not well enough.
It was a magical time. It really was. But when I think of Milwaukee and true crime, I think of, I was going to say Hillside Strength. Sorry, wrong.
Or maybe you're thinking of him.
I know there was another person whom also drove a yellow VW Bug. Wait, like there's four major serial killers in the States that were known to drive yellow VW Bugs.
And we love that it adds the darkness tone to our story, right?
Yeah, so what's up with a VW Bug, a yellow one in particular? But I think of Milwaukee, I think of Jeffrey Dahmer.
Of course,
right?
Yeah.
So would anyone be familiar with the true crime case that you're basing this show on? Maybe like, oh yeah, okay.
We believe so. We believe enough has been put into it that anybody who would follow a true crime case enough, and I don't want to say a fan because I want to use that very loosely around these individuals, a person that you've been maybe researching or studying enough, you would know if you've been minimally doing it. You would probably know what our show is about.
Okay.
Yeah.
But to bring it back to that Tarantino idea as well, we really hope like. No hopes are brought up because we are also rewriting history in that sense. Like Tarantino, like you think of Inglourious Basterds, you think of Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. Those are real events that he kind of flipped and twisted around to suit his universe.
Right.
So like even if you are the true crime fan, like this One Night in Milwaukee really is still an original piece.
Your own take on history.
Around it, yeah.
Like Titanic.
Oh, goodness. Yes. Yeah. Jack was real, right? Yeah.
There was room. Hopefully. There was room on that on that big old floating door.
Yeah.
So what's you're playing in the warehouse?
The warehouse space, yeah.
Okay, and I found out recently that they're going to be streaming.
Of course.
Streaming live.
Yes. That's awesome.
Yeah, yeah, that was kind of streaming. Everything. Okay, yeah. That's great.
We have lots of family that are out of the province, so and friends for that matter, so this streaming is very... we thank the Fringe, we thank everybody doing that, part of the streaming services and getting those cameras in there, because it's lots of work to do it, and but the outcome is amazing. So we are streaming, and I think that starts the Thursday, I believe. Mm-hmm. I hope I'm not making half this stuff up. But no, all the stuff, they have a beautiful website, you can go on there. But I believe Thursday is when you can get those streaming tickets onwards from
Okay,
Friday.
Great. And any social media for this production that we can check out and
yeah.
follow?
Yeah, it would be on Virgo Theater Company on Instagram and Virgo Theater Company on Facebook. And we have been updating for probably week by week, seeing with the events have been happening.
Yeah. Great, great. And Quinn, you're still doing the ARC in the cemetery.
Yes, the Loyalist Burial Ground project. So that is wrapping up the same week as the Fringe. So there's the matinee performances for that. 2 p.m. running from Wednesday to Saturday next week. So yeah, it's going to be a busy week, but yeah. lots of theater, lots of fun.
Well, congratulations on being busy. Congratulations on the show. I hope everything goes well. Thank Break you. Legs. And anything else you wanted to mention before we wrap her up?
86 Princess Street, guys, the warehouse. It's a beautiful spot in there. St. John Theatre Company is utilizing that space and has just brought out a lot of potential in it. And it's right past the St. John Theatre Company building, right past the St. John Tool Library, right on your left. And you'll see the little billboard and sign there. And we can't wait to see you there. Thank you so much, and thank you, Tim.
Well, no, thank you, Cameron. Thank you, Quinn.
Thank you so much for having us, Tim. And I hope to see you all this week at One Night in Milwaukee.
One Night in Milwaukee. Great.
That was Cameron Secord and Quinn Adams from St. John's Virgo Theater. Their production, One Night in Milwaukee, is playing now, August 21st to the 27th. So look up the Fundy Fringe on Facebook or Virgo Theater for the day's showtime. Also, check out the ARC, ARC, Atlantic Repertory Company's The Loyalist Burial Ground Project, also this week. Quinn's going to be one tired guy after all of this. While I'm at it, I'll throw in an apology here for trying to one-up Cameron and Quinn with my lame Irish theater anecdote. Also, the Happy Days reference. Folks, I am so excited to hear the response that you've been giving me about the segments showcasing the musical content we've had on the show over the last 10 years, especially the music related to Canadian film projects that I was exposed to during my time as the Cinecube Film Accelerator's Uber fan. The hashtag UberTim. Thank you for supporting Canadian films for Canadian audiences in Canadian cinemas and beyond. Back by popular demand, and used with permission by singer-songwriter Mackenzie Gray, you may also know him as an older Lex Luthor from Smallville, the Eye from Legion, Lux du Jour from Dirk Gently's Holistic Detective Agency, over 200 films and TV shows, 100 plays, and okay, I'm basically name-dropping now. I apologize. Here is the new remix version of Lick You With Love from the Earthlickers soundtrack.
Lick long and prosper. Somewhere south.
That was the new recording of Lick You With Love from the Earthlickers soundtrack. Lyrics and music by Mackenzie Gray. Lead vocals, Karen Holness. Background vocals, Amy Alexander, Liza Cosier, Justine Warrington, Alison Araya, and Mackenzie Gray. All guitars by Mackenzie Gray. Funk, clavichord, and pianos, Joe Docherty. Electric piano, Mackenzie Gray. Bass, Mackenzie Gray and Joe Docherty. Strings composed and arranged by Joe Docherty. Drums by Joe Docherty. Mix engineered by Lucas Ross. Produced by Joe Docherty, Mackenzie Gray, and Lucas Ross. Copyright 2015 Mackenzie Gray for the song, and copyright 2019 Mackenzie Gray for this recording. Made for Earthlickers, a feature film by Justine Warrington and Alison Araya. Whew! Coming to a theater near you. Hashtag Earthlickers, hashtag Lick Long and Prosper. Mackenzie wanted to formally acknowledge producer Joe Docherty's brilliant work and Lucas Ross's strong edits and great mix, taking the raw original and turning it into a dynamic hit number. Thank you, Mackenzie Gray, and everyone who worked on the music and film. Thanks also to my guests Tom Hearn, Cameron Secord, Quinn Adams, and Tabraze and Robin Sheikh. They even fed me. How did they even know I was low on cash? Oh, yeah, they're mind readers. But did I finally get to do the Wrath of Non challenge? We'll find out right after a word from our sponsor. Baba Ganoush, it's portable!
Thank you, Tabraze. Thank you, Robin. Yeah. So, wait, what is this here? This is honey, you say honey...
Garlic.
Wonderful. Okay, so this isn't honey here, though.
No, that is the Wrath of Non sauce.
This is the Wrath of Non sauce, okay. Now, you know, I miss doing the Wrath of Non challenge. Mm. I'm hoping I can convince you in the future to have just a Wrath of Non festival for a weekend. Once you get the restaurant going. Okay, so I'm going to try this here. This is your concoction.
Yep.
You made this sauce yourself. Mm-hmm. Okay. I'm going to just dab. That's what? That's a good dab.
That's an okay dab.
Mmm. Okay. Yeah. That's a burn. What am I tasting there? What is it?
Pain.
Oh yeah, no, that's hot.
The beauty is, it actually, the way I, so you know I'm a little bit of a chemistry buff.
Mm-hmm.
I designed it in such a way that it comes in waves. So the waves get hotter and hotter, so you've probably noticed it's getting a little warmer.
Yep. Okay, that's in bite number two. I'm just kissing it into the, and now I'm good for hot, so the idea.
Already getting the hiccups, I can see.
I am. That's the idea for this was that you had to eat a whole cup of this with the naan without crying or complaining.
No, you couldn't. No, everyone cried and complained. You had to finish it without vomiting. You just had to finish it, really.
This is great. Actually, no, it is quite hot. It's quite hot.
Now there is an activator that I didn't put in there.
What is the activator?
So again.
Okay, I'm tearing up. Yeah.
So, your next dip.
Yep.
I'm gonna sprinkle on a little bit of the activator.
Oh
now,
boy.
The activator was a mix of Pakistani spices that, for some reason,
water.
The chemistry worked. Oh yeah, you're not supposed to drink water when you do the Wrath of Non.
Oh wait, really? You can't.
But you're not really doing the challenge.
I'm not really doing the challenge. Yeah. Okay. So, I'll commit to you one day.
Yeah. But the way the activator works is, the second, so the activator was in the meat of the naan.
Okay.
So many people would eat the meat and be like, oh, it's not that hot, or they'd take the spice, oh, it's not that bad. But when you put the two together, all of a sudden it's like, holy crap, what is this?
Mmm. But you'll still be, you'll still be able to get the hot sauce at the restaurant, right?
No.
No, this is it?
This is it.
Let's go over here.
This is the last of the hot sauce, the hottest hot sauce in New Brunswick. This is the last of it. You barely dusted it. There's
take that.
Yep.
Dip it in there.
Okay. I'm dipping that, the sprinkled stuff, that the stuff you sprinkled on there,
yep.
I'm dipping it in there too.
Now eat it together.
Okay.
And all of a sudden it's going to go, holy crap, why is this burning?
Are you tearing up?
I am crying.
See what I mean? Like, all of a sudden, it's just like, boom, what is this?
Yeah, but it's flavorful. But yeah, that's really hot. I think,
the rest are for you, please.
Oh, I appreciate that. I'm probably going to need it to soothe my taste buds there. No, that's great. Wonderful. I probably won't be able to talk much longer. But thank you very much for the opportunity to try the hottest hot sauce on probably on the East Coast?
Probably.
Which is now extinct.
For legal reasons. No, just kidding.
This is all kosher, right?
Halal, yeah.
Halal, perfect. It all works.